Okay. I want us to turn to 1 Samuel 25 because this is where we're going to be looking at tonight. I'm going to be going to other parts of the Bible, but you stay in 1 Samuel 25 and you better follow most of it as we go through. And we're going to see an amazing story here, which we're going to share some things tonight out of this one chapter. It's just incredible. There's an interesting verse in Genesis 43. You stay in 1 Samuel 25 because I will be spending a lot of time there. But in Genesis 43, they asked him of their welfare and said, "The old man of whom you spake, is he yet alive?" Amen. The old man of whom you spake, is he yet alive? And because we know the Bible talks about how old man, amen? And that old man is our old nature. Is he yet alive? Now the Apostle Paul in Romans 7 and a few of the first verses there, he talks about natural things in marriage and then he takes it into a spiritual realm, and he often does that. Talks about a marriage and then he takes and starts talking about Christ and the church. So in Romans 7:1 he said, "Know ye not, brethren, for I speak to them that know their law, how that the law hath dominion over men as long as he liveth. For the woman which hath a husband," verse 2, "is bound by the law to her husband so long as he liveth. But if her husband be dead, she is loosed from the law of her husband. So," in verse 3, "then if while her husband liveth, she be married to another man, she shall be called an adulteress. But if her husband be dead, she is free from that law. So she's no adulteress, though she be married to another man." And then all of a sudden, in verse 4, Paul changes. And he says, excuse me, "Wherefore, my brethren, you also become dead to the law by the body of Christ, that you should be married to another, even to whom is raised from the dead, that we should bring forth fruit unto God." So it's amazing how the Apostle Paul does that. He's talking about a natural thing and all of a sudden he goes through and talks about something that's spiritual. And there's a reason for this and we're going to see that. See, in that last verse, that you should be married to what? Another. You know what that means, don't you? You've been married to something else. Amen? Kind of unusual scriptures, these. But that you should be married to another. So for that to take place, the old man has got to die. Amen? And the old man is what we've been married to because of the fall. We come into this world joined to an old man, the old nature. Amen? Now the Apostle Paul says that you become dead to the law by the body of Christ, that you should be married to another. So we're going to see this. Now the Bible talks about the old man, like Romans 6:6, "Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him." Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, "If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things have passed away." Ephesians 4:22, "You put off concerning the former conversation the old man." Amen. Colossians 3:9, "Lie not one to another, seeing you've put off the old man with his deeds." And the Bible talks about a new man. "Make himself twain one new man." Ephesians 2:15. Ephesians 2:24, "That you put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness." Colossians 3:10. "And they put on the new man, which is renewed in the knowledge of the image of him that created him." Amen. And so there's the talk in the Bible about the old man. There's talk about the new man. That's what we're going to talk about tonight. The old man and the new man. Amen? The old man's no good. He's got to die. So I don't want you to have any mercy for the old man, okay? Don't get soft on it. The old man's got to die. And we have this wonderful story in 1 Samuel 25, which shows us lots of the principles that happen here. So let's go to 1 Samuel 25. And verse 2, "And there was a man in Moan whose possessions were in Carmel, and the man was very great." This is what made a great man in those days. He had 3,000 sheep, 1,000 goats. Anybody got 1,000 goats? God bless you, I see it hand, you may take it down. I know someone in Tasmania that's got 500 goats that they milk. Quite an amazing thing, and I've been up there when they're milking the goats, and he goes up in his little four-wheel, you know, these little motorbike things with four wheels, you can go all over the place. And he goes up there to get the goats, and all the goats start coming down to the shed to be milked. But one goat jumps on his little tractor. And every time she jumps on his little tractor, she's got to ride down to the shed with her master. Amen? But anyway, this guy, he had more than that. He had 1,000 goats and 1,000 sheep. And he was shearing his sheep in 1,000 sheep, sorry, and 1,000 goats. And he was shearing his sheep in Carmel. Now, verse 3 says, the name of the man was Nabal, and the name of his wife was Abigail. Now here, you must understand that this man here represents our old sinful nature. You understand that? She's married to it. And the Bible says the name of his wife was Abigail. She was a woman of good understanding out of a beautiful countenance. But the man, I like the way the Bible says, but the man. Well, you know, you could put him in one phrase. He was a rat bag. He was a terrible man. She was of good understanding. She had a beautiful countenance, but the man was churlish. That means he was rough, and he was evil in his doings. Evil in his doings. So here you've got a real mixture, you see, because the husband is your Lord. You know, Sarah called Abraham Lord. And so the thing that is ruling her life, even though she's of good understanding, has a beautiful countenance, the thing that's ruling her life is evil in its doings, the Bible says. Evil in his doings. Churlish and rough. And yet she was of a beautiful countenance. What a horrible situation we have here. But that's what we have through the fall. We're born married to the old nature, to the old man. And before we can be married to another, he's got to die. Amen? Now, there's the talk. The Bible talks about the marriage supper of the Lamb, doesn't it? Is he dead yet? Is the old man dead yet? See, we're going to find some interesting things about that. Because we can't have the marriage until the old man's dead. Amen. And so it's a very interesting story. Okay, so let's go on through. But you know, this is an interesting combination, because you've got some good things and you've got some things that are beautiful countenance. But you've also got some bad things that's rough and evil in its doings. And because God created us in the image of God, even the fallen man, sometimes you can see some good stuff there. It's the fingerprints of God. It's kind of left there. God can't create us without leaving his fingerprints on us. We were made in the image of God. We are fallen. But there's still some, there can be sometimes some beautiful things there. Sometimes some people in the world can be better than the so-called Christian. You didn't hear me say that, did you? Did anyone hear what I said? What did I say? Christians. Okay. I mean, it's a terrible thing, but, you know, that can happen sometimes. I know someone that wanted someone to do some carpentry work, and when the guy told me he's Christian, he said, oh, no, I've had a bit of a bad time with Christians. It's terrible, isn't it, that there should be bad witnesses like that around, but there is. But here it is, you see. And so here we go. Now, we continue the story. And so he was evil in his doings, the Bible says. Henry's concise commentary says, Nabal looked very mean. He had no honor or honesty. He was churlish, cross, ill-humored, evil in his doings, hard, oppressive, a man that cared not what fraud and violence he used in getting and saving. Terrible. Amen. And so that's the story that we have about him. Now, we're going to see the story of the struggle. And I just want to read Spurgeon, because there's a struggle. We come to Christ, and the moment Christ comes in, he's going to start dealing with that old nature, with that old man. I like what Spurgeon said. I think it's important. We need to hang on to this as we go through the story. I'll just read what he says about the inward conflicts of a Christian. Thus, if time did not fail us, we might go through all these men who have at any time served the Church of God, and say of them all that they have experienced, felt, and confessed a struggle and a conflict between what God has implanted and what nature has left in them. But there's no conflict to any high degree in the ungodly man. Because while the strong man keepeth the house, his goods are at peace. So long as Satan's got a hold of a person, he's, while there is one master, a man may cheerfully serve him. But in the moment of regeneration, Spurgeon said, a new master comes into the house, a stronger than he has come, and he will bind the strong man, and after many conflicts, cast him out forever, and get the house to be his own possession. I love that. And he goes on to say, the new nature which God implants in his people is directly the opposite to the old one. As the old nature comes of Satan, being defiled and depraved by the fall, so the new nature cometh direct from heaven, pure and without spot. As the old nature is sin and is essentially sin, so the new nature is essentially grace. It is the living, incorruptible seed which liveth and abideth forever, a seed which cannot sin, because it is born of God. We have these two, therefore, come together into conflict. It is when fire and water meet, either the one or the other must die. If there be in you no conflict, it's because there is no divine power come there to drive the evil one out. The more of these wars and fightings you feel, the more you have cause to thank God and take courage. The battle's not yours, but it's God. Amen? Amen. Well, I'll inject my own thought here. Jesus, the Bible says in Jude, will present out faultless before the Father with exceeding joy. He's the author and the finish of our faith. He's began a good work in us, amen, and he will finish it. The battle's not yours but God. You didn't go to war for it your own charges. You shall overcome as thousands have done before. You through the blood of the Lamb are, brethren, these things may change, as I have said, but the war is never. Do not any of you say, I shall never be tempted again. Grey-headed brethren, do not think that the old man is dead. If professors fall into grave sin and dishonor the church, then they are often old men as young. I think I may say that there are often older men than younger ones, and it's sad to be so, but it is so. No, we shall never be out of the gunshot of the devil till we've crossed the river of death. Some will say, but why does God not remove out of the Christian the old nature? Some uninstructed Christians even think that in conversion the Lord turns the old nature into a new one straight away, which is very far from the fact. The old nature remains in the Christian. It has received a blow. I want you to remember this. It's very important that we remember this, because George Whitfield said the same thing. John Wesley said the same thing, and Finney said the same thing as what Spurgeon says. The old nature has received a blow. Received a blow, which will ultimately be its death. But it still lives, and the new nature and the Christian comes to struggle with it for the mastery. The battle certainly will end right. Just anticipate for a moment the glory of the victory. You shall be free from sin. You shall be perfect, even as your Father is in heaven is perfect. You shall wave the palm branches in glory. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. But there's a struggle going on. If anybody's perfect now, put your hand up. God bless you. I see that hand. God bless you. May take them down. Amen. It's like someone came to Spurgeon and said to Spurgeon, because they had the doctrine of perfection in those days, full sanctification, perfection, and this brother came to Spurgeon and said, I've reached perfection. So Mr. Spurgeon asked him to sit down, and the man spent about a quarter of an hour telling his experience that he'd reached perfection. So Mr. Spurgeon said with a little smile on his face, very quietly, I would like to talk to your wife. Wasn't he a smart man? I would like to talk to your wife. Because if anyone knows whether the husband has reached perfection, it probably might be the wife. And the moment Mr. Spurgeon said quietly to him, I'd like to talk to your wife, the man lost his temper. He knew he was in trouble straight away, and it burst his little perfection bubble. Amen? Absolutely. Amen. You see, God's got to do it. The Bible says in Zephaniah 3 verse 15, the Lord hath taken away thy judgments. He hath cast out thy enemy. Amen? That old nature. The Lord even is in the midst of thee, and thou shalt not see evil anymore. Praise God. Thou shalt not see evil any more. For the Lord thy God in the midst of thee is mighty. He will rejoice over thee with joy. He shall rest in his love, and he will joy over thee with singing. Now coming back to 1 Samuel again. In a moment, sorry, I just want to read 1 Samuel 16. And it's interesting, because here's this woman of beautiful countenance. There's something there that's beautiful. Abigail was a beautiful countenance, even though the Lord that ruled her life was what? evil in his doings. Now there's another man we want to look at. It says in 1 Samuel 16:12, and he sent and brought him in. This is David. This is when Samuel wanted to anoint one of the sons. And he said, well, what's going on here? I've looked at all your sons and none of them are the one that God's chosen. Is there anybody else? And the father says, oh, I forgot about David, you know. He's out there in the field. We didn't even bring him in because I didn't think he'd he didn't think that David would be, you know, material to be a king over Israel. So he didn't bother calling him. Amen. God's ways aren't our ways. Amen. God takes the things that are despised. And so he was called. And now he was ruddy and of a what?
Beautiful countenance.
A beautiful countenance. And the Lord said to Samuel, and arise and anoint him, for this is he. Amen. Of a beautiful countenance. You see, it's kind of interesting. But God's going to bring these two beautiful countenances together. He's going to bring Abigail, because you know Abigail married David. She's going to bring Abigail to David and David to Abigail. And they're going to be married. A wonderful picture of you and I being married to Christ. Amen? So we're going to learn some principles out of this story. Okay. And so you see how countenance tells a lot, doesn't it? You ever notice that? If someone is angry with you, can't you tell it by looking at their face? If someone despises you, you can tell it by looking at their face. The Bible says in Genesis 4:6, the Lord said unto Cain, why art thou wroth? Why are you angry? And why is thy countenance fallen? A fallen countenance is quite something. But God said he's going to lift up his countenance upon us. Amen? That's what he wants to do. Why is your countenance fallen? The Bible says in Judges 13:6, a man of God came unto me and his countenance was like the countenance of an angel. That's different, isn't it, to a fallen countenance. Look like an angel. Has anyone ever called you or thought that you look like an angel? God bless you. Anybody else? Anyone else look like an angel? Someone told me I looked like an angel once. Once, I can remember. And it was an unusual circumstance. It really, really was. When you're traveling, sometimes people put you in unusual circumstances. I was traveling through this town in New Zealand preaching, and a husband and her wife said, you've got to come to the hospital. There's someone who's only got a few hours to live, and for some reason they thought I was the answer. So they took me to the hospital. The moment I walk into the hospital, they tell the matron, she was a hard woman. That's unusual for a matron, I know, but she was a tough lady because I met her. And they told the matron they're bringing this preacher in, and she obviously didn't like preachers or maybe had a bad experience with a preacher one time at the hospital, so she just dresses me down. And I thought, what am I doing? I'm just traveling through preaching and now I've got a matron dressing me down and all I've been doing is asked to go to the hospital to visit someone and she's given me the third order. She tells me, now you can't do anything in there. The lady is unconscious and she will not regain consciousness. She only has a few hours to live. You won't be able to talk to her. You won't be able to pray for her or anything you think you want to do. And all the relatives around the bed crying. So you need to be very careful what you do, Pastor. And she just told me straight. So I thought, okay, thank you. And I began to wonder, what am I doing here? And I walked into the room and sure enough there's crying going on and the lady's propped up with pillows and her skin's all different colours. You know, some people do sometimes the last stages of cancer. She's got some splotches on her and she was looking so sick and she was unconscious. Just like the matron said, she was unconscious. And I'm standing there and these people have brought me expecting me to do something. And I said, Lord, help me. I don't know what to do. And as I prayed, I said, Lord, I don't know what to do. I said, Lord, help me. Oh, I couldn't believe it. All of a sudden, that sick lady, the matron said, will never be conscious, opened up her eyes and looked straight at me. Suddenly, just like that, she regained consciousness, looked straight at me. You know what happened? God, I thank God for that. I forgot all the people were in the room. Honestly. I forgot they were there. I went straight up to her and took a hold of her hand. I held her hand. And I said, if you can understand what I'm saying when I talk, just squeeze my hand. She didn't have much strength, but that weak, frail little hand squeezed my hand just a little bit. And I said, pray. I thought, praise God, we're communicating. Mm-hmm. Communicating, you know, I was just hoping the matron wouldn't walk in right now. And so I told her, I said, you don't have long to live. I knew I had to tell her that. And I said, you need to accept Christ as your Savior. And I talked a bit about that. I'd forgotten about the relatives. I don't know what they were thinking. I said, you need to accept Christ as your Savior. I said, would you like to do that? Just squeeze my hand. And with all her effort, she squeezed my hand. I want to accept Christ as my Savior. Praise God. Amen. And then I took her through the prayer with her. I prayed with her about her life being committed to Christ. And when I prayed what I felt to pray, I let her hand go. And just as she was, just her hand was leaving my hand, she squeezed me one more time, like saying, thank you. And she had tears in her eyes. It was a powerful time. God came down. And then as I stood back, the lady looked at me and said, this man is an angel. Now, I'm no angel. But she didn't see me. She saw the Lord.
Amen.
Amen? Amen. The Bible says we have the treasure in the earthen vessel and the powers of God and not of us. And then she looked around all the relatives who are now crying. They're all crying. I don't know. I reckon God did something in that place that day. And they were all crying, wiping tears out of their eyes. And she said, looked at all her relatives. And every now and again kept saying, he's an angel. That man's an angel. She looked at all her relatives, straight in their eyes, she looked at them all. And then she looked at me one more time and just said those words one last time, he's an angel. Went unconscious. And in 3 or 4 hours, she was dead. And the matron said she wasn't going to gain consciousness. But see, I was forced into that situation. I didn't know what I was walking into. But all I know is I cried out to God. I said, God, help me. I don't know what to do. The matron said she'll never gain consciousness. She's in the final throes of her death. But God rallied her around so she could accept Christ. Isn't that fantastic? That's what God can do. Amen. And that's what the Bible says here. His countenance was like the angel of God. You know, Stephen, when just before he's been martyred, the Bible says his face looked like an angel. He saw Jesus at the right hand of the Father. Amen. So sometimes God can let things slip out. And we have the treasure in the earthen vessel, but it's not us, it's God, it's Christ in us. Amen. And all of that sort of thing. Amen. But see, the Bible says a merry heart maketh a cheerful countenance. I know in other places a merry heart doeth good like a medicine. But a merry heart makes a cheerful countenance. Amen? Jesus said, when you fast, don't be like the hypocrites of a sad countenance. So we can have all sorts of countenances. Amen? And so we don't want to go on with that because there's a lot of it. Okay. And the Bible says now, so okay, she's married to this thing which is evil in its doings. God says in Job 28:28, behold, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom, and to depart from evil is understanding. We need to depart from evil. In the Lord's Prayer, we have deliver us from evil. Depart from evil is understanding. You need more than wisdom. Wisdom and understanding are two different things, but understanding is always to depart from evil. See, Solomon had a lot of wisdom, but not enough understanding. Understanding is to depart from evil. Amen? And the Bible says, he that hath understanding will know the mark of the beast, what it is. 666. You've got to have understanding. And that's to depart from evil. The Bible says in Proverbs 3:7, the fear of the Lord is to depart from evil. The Bible says in Proverbs Psalm 34:14, depart from evil, do good, and seek peace and pursue it. Psalm 37:27, depart from evil, do good, and dwell forevermore. That's lovely. Dwell forevermore. Bible says in Proverbs 16:6, the fear of the Lord is to depart from evil. You see, the man in the world, he doesn't depart from evil. In fact, he's got a different kind of wisdom. The Bible says in Jeremiah 4:22, they have no understanding, they are wise to do evil. They have no understanding, so they won't depart from evil. They actually have wisdom to do evil. They learn the craft of doing evil. Amen. They pursue evil. That's where they live. The Bible says in Psalm 53:2, to see if there were any that did understand, that did seek God. The Bible says, good understanding have all those that do his commandments. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast. Okay, so there's a way with God. Let everyone that names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. The highway of the upright, it says, is to depart from evil. A highway shall be there, Isaiah 35:8, and a way, and it shall be called the way of holiness, and the redeemed shall walk there. The people of the New Testament were called people of the way. It says that if they found any of this way, woman or man, they persecuted them, expounded them the way of God more perfectly. So that's what they were like. Anyway, so thank God the Lord takes us from evil. He delivers us from evil. He keeps us from evil, the Bible says. Job talks about how the angel redeemed me from evil. And so the Lord's got a lot of promises there. He preserves us from, delivers us from evil, as in the Lord's Prayer, of course. Okay, coming back to 1 Samuel 25. And verse 4. David heard in the wilderness that Nabal did shear his sheep. And in verse 5, David sent out 10 young men, and David said unto the young men, get up to Carmel and go to Nabal and greet him in my name. Now David, you've got to realize, had actually been protecting this man's sheep. Okay? We're going to get into the story, and it's going to get pretty deep soon. We're going to see some wonderful truths here. Anyway, how did Nabal react to David? It says in 1 Samuel 25:9, and when David's young men came, they spake to Nabal according to all the words in the name of David and ceased. How did Nabal react? Here it is in verse 10. Nabal answered David's servant and said, who is David? Who is the son of Jesse? There be many servants nowadays that break away every man from his master. Doesn't that remind you of someone else? Pharaoh said in Exodus 5:2, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? I know not the Lord. Amen. Time God had finished with Pharaoh, he knew who the Lord was. Amen. He knew who the Lord was. And here's Nabal saying, who's David? I don't know who David is. Amen. Okay. But the Bible there said in Isaiah 11:1, there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. Praise God. And then he went on to say in verse 11, Nabal said, shall I take my bread, my water, my flesh that I've killed from my shearers, and give it to men whom I know not whence they be? He wasn't a very friendly sort of a guy. He wasn't given to hospitality, was he? This guy gets worse and worse as we go down the story. Okay? So David's young men turned their way, verse 12, and went again and came and told him all these things. But, it says in verse 14, but. Whenever there's a but, you need to check it out. But one of the young men told Abigail, Nabal's wife, saying, behold, David sent messengers out of the wilderness to salute our master, and he railed on them. That means he got really angry with them. But the men were very good unto us. Verse 15, and we were not hurt, neither missed we anything, as long as we were conversant with them. They were in the fields. They were a wall unto us, both by night and day, all the while we were with them, keeping the sheep. In other words, they were helping them. And in verse 17, this man that came to Abigail, you notice he didn't come to Nabal. Why would you want to come to him and talk to him? He came to the better part, the one of good understanding. And he said, now therefore, and consider, verse 17, what wilt thou do? For evil is determined against our master and against all his household. For he's such a, listen to this, for he's such a son of Belial that a man can't speak to him. Not very nice, is it? But it's true. And this guy's saying to Abigail, and I can imagine, this is just my imagination now, that Abigail in her mind is saying, amen, you're right. He's a rotter. Because remember, we can't spare this guy. Come on now. This guy's evil in his doings. Now don't get soft on him. He's such a son of Belial that a man cannot speak to him. You cannot speak. When you go out to witness to a lot of people, you're talking to that rotten old fallen nature. You can't speak to it. It'll rail on you. It'll scoff you. It'll laugh in your face. Amen? Sometimes God puts that down. You start talking to the part that's got a bit of hope if it will reach out to Jesus, the part with a bit of good understanding. But you can't talk to this man. Okay. And it says in verse 18, then Abigail made haste. That was a good getaway, wasn't it? Wow, they've been well trained. Then Abigail made haste and took 200 loaves and 2 bottles of wine, and boy, she put together something pretty quick. Took 200 loaves, 2 bottles of wine, 5 sheep dressed, 5 measures of parched corn, 100 clusters of raisins, 200 cakes of fig. Glory to God, that's nice. And laid them on asses. And she said unto her servants, go up before me. Behold, I come after you. But she told not her husband Nabal. How could she tell him? How? There was no good in that man. If she had told her husband what she was about to do, he would have stopped the whole thing. Amen? Mm-hmm. Now, this is just my imagination. This is kind of like she's gone out to a meeting. You know? She's going to meet with David, of course, but things are going to happen. If you go to a meeting where God's people are, things are going to happen. Amen? Mm-hmm. She didn't tell him. And it was so, verse 20, look, we're getting through this chapter quick at the moment. She rode on the ass that she came down by the covert of the hill, and behold, David and his men came down against her, and she met them. And we'll drop down to verse 23. And when Abigail saw David, what did she do? She hasted, lighted off the ass, fell before David on her face. Can you get any lower than that? Fell before David on her face, but she does get lower than that. And bowed herself to the ground. And she's getting lower. And fell at his feet. I want to stop there. This woman is desperate. Amen? As soon as she sees David, she's on her face, bowing herself down, falling at his feet, because she's been married to this wicked, evil man that's evil in its doings. She is desperate. And she says, my Lord. Oh, this is amazing. She calls David my Lord. Amen. You know what? She calls Lord David Lord 25 times. She's applying a principle of deliverance right there. My Lord, upon me let this iniquity be, and let, oh my goodness, let thine handmaid. She's calling herself David's handmaid. She said, you're my Lord, and I'm your handmaid. I pray thee, speak in thy audience, and hear the words of thy handmaid. Very powerful things happening here. And you see, I want you to change your thinking on this now, and you'll see something beautiful. Right now, Abigail's before David, just like we need to be before Jesus Christ, because we're desperate too. We've been born in sin. We've been born with this old nature. We are desperate. We need all the help we can get. Amen. And so she just says, David, you're my Lord. And then, she's there before David. If you're going to be a real Christian, you've got to be like that. You've got to bow yourself down before Jesus. Or like what Spurgeon said, you've got to be like Daniel. Lay at his feet as dead. And Spurgeon said, we're never more alive when we're dead at his feet. Amen? Desperate for help. And then she says in verse 25, let my Lord, see, she's calling him Lord. Let my Lord, I pray thee, regard not this man of Belial, even Nabal. Look what she says. For as his name is, so is he. Wow. Nabal is his name, and folly is with him. In other words, she said, this man is a fool. What does the fool say? The fool has said in his heart, there is know God. And when you deal with unsaved people out there, when you hit that rotten old evil nature that's in them, that's always going to talk like that. I don't believe in God. There is no God. If they can't get around it, they say, well, who created God? And all sorts of rubbish. And so she said, his name is Nabal, which means a fool, and folly is with him. But I, thy handmaid, saw not the young man of my Lord. My Lord, all the time, it's my Lord, whom thou didst see. Now that's the thing. You see, when you first come to Christ, that's the first thing you're going to say. You're going to say what she says. She said, don't look at this rotten nature of mine. Don't regard this son of Belial. Don't regard this thing that's been ruling in my life that's evil and its doings. This is what she's saying to David. Amen? And then what are you going to say next real quick? What she said real quick. What she said real quick. We'll see it in a moment. I'm just looking at a few other scriptures. The Bible says that if I regard iniquity in your heart, the Lord will not hear me. God's begun a good work in us. He's going to finish it. Amen. Good things are found. Nevertheless, good things are found in thee. It says in one of the kings. Okay. And then, so what is she going to say straight away? Look what she says. Verse 28. I pray thee, forgive the trespasses of thy handmaid. Isn't that powerful? She said, first of all, don't regard my old nature. Don't, Lord, please don't look at me. I'm full of rottenness. Don't look at that thing that's ruling my life. But I want you to forgive. Amen? We don't waste any time, do we? This is a picture of what it is to become a real Christian. I want you to forgive the trespass of the handmaid. Amen? And we need forgiveness, you know. We've got to come down. We've got to humble ourselves. Amen? And come down if we want forgiveness. You ever had to ask someone for forgiveness? At a dinner party, this is a true story, at a dinner party one night, Lady Churchill, you heard of Sir Winston Churchill? Yeah. Was sitting opposite Sir Winston Churchill next to a lady, and every now and again Sir Winston Churchill on the table went like this with his fingers. He bent his fingers down like this and went crawling, walking on his fingers like this towards his wife. Like that. Then he'd stop and leave it for a while, and then he'd go on the table again. Stop for a little while and then go back a bit, come up. And this was happening a few times. So Winston kept making his hands walk up and down, two fingers bent at the knuckles. And the fingers were walking towards Lady Churchill. Finally, the dinner partner asked, why is Sir Winston looking so wistfully at you? And whatever is he doing with those knuckles on the table? That's simple, she replied. We had a mild quarrel before we left home, and he's indicating that it's his fault. And he's on his knees to me in apology and asking for forgiveness. Isn't that a nice story? Asking for forgiveness. And we've got to come to Jesus and ask for forgiveness. Amen? Do you know that Sir Walter Scott, you ever heard of Sir Walter Scott? He went to the South Pole. Do you know he became a Christian? And Sir Walter Scott had difficulty with the idea of turning the other cheek. But Jesus' words, Sir Walter Scott says in one of his writings, took special meaning one day. When Scott threw a rock, he threw a rock at a stray dog to chase it away, and his aim was straighter and his delivery stronger than he had intended, for he hit the animal in its back leg and broke its leg with this big rock. Threw the rock at the dog and broke its back leg. Instead of running off, the dog limped over to him and licked the hand that threw the rock. Licked the hand that threw the rock. And Sir Walter said, I never forgot that touching response. He said, that dog preached to me that day. That dog preached the Sermon on the Mount to me more than few ministers have ever presented it to me. He said, I've not found human beings so readily to forgive their enemies. Amazing, God can use his creation to speak to us. Amen. Okay. God is ready to forgive, the Bible says in Psalm 86:5, and plenteous in mercy unto all that call upon him. God has plenty of mercy. He's got plenty of forgiveness if we'll just call to him. Amen. Jesus, you know, most powerful words on the cross. There were a lot of powerful words on the cross. But Jesus, with the blood running out of him, and he had wounds in his head and in his hands and his feet and sword and things and all the wounds on his back, there was so much blood running out of Jesus. You can only lose 7 pints of blood and you're dead. 8 pints, you are finished. I know men that lost almost 7 pints of blood when they got into hospital. They reckon it was a miracle. They got blood into him. They transfused blood into him, but they reckon it was a miracle he lived, because he'd lost so much blood. But Jesus, with all this blood pouring out of him, he had to say something while the blood was pouring out of him, because he wanted it to be tied together. And what did he say? Father, forgive them. Isn't that great? We have forgiveness through Jesus Christ, because God the Father heard that cry. He does not turn away the cry of his son when his life was pouring out of him. The life is in the flesh. It was running out of him. And Jesus said those immortal words that God the Father never forgets. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. None of us know what we do. We're just so controlled by the evil one before we come to Christ. Amen. He's plenteous in mercy and forgiveness. And he forgives us. You know, one time John Wesley, the great revival preacher, was walking with a general of the army. And he said to John Wesley, I never forgive and I never forget. And John Wesley looked at him and said, sir, I hope you never sin. Amen. Because listen, folks, we've got to get this in our spirit real strongly. As much mercy as we show to other people, God will show to us. Amen. As much forgiveness as we show to other people, God will show to us. We're in a pretty sad state if we don't have a forgiving heart or show much mercy. Amen. So he said, I hope you never sin. Anyway, coming back to Samuel. 1 Samuel 25, verse 28. Look what she's saying now. After asking him to forgive her, she goes on to say, for the Lord will certainly make my Lord a sure house. That's the Lord God will make for my Lord a sure house, because my Lord fighteth the battles of the Lord. There's a lot of Lords here. And listen to this. And evil hath not been found in thee all thy days. Amen. You see, David was a type of Christ here. Now, there's no type of Christ in the Old Testament that's perfect. They all break down. Amen? Because Christ is the only perfect one. Probably the one that's nearest to being perfect type of Christ in the Old Testament would be Joseph. But even he, there was a breakdown. Because none of them could reap, none of them were in that place. Only Jesus could be in that place. But there's wonderful lessons here, because we learn something. And she's saying of David, evil hath not been found in the all thy days. She's married to something that's opposite to that. She's married to something that's what? Evil in its doings. And now she sees David, a type of Christ, and says, evil hath not been found in the all thy days. She wants this. Amen? She wants it. She wants to be joined to something that has no evil in it. And you fight the battles of the Lord's. We'll see something here in a minute. And then she said in verse 30, it shall come to pass when the Lord shall have done to my Lord according to all the good that he has spoken concerning thee, and shall have appointed thee ruler over Israel. Look what she says. That this shall be no grief unto thee, nor offense of heart unto my Lord, that my Lord hath avenged himself. But when the Lord shall have dealt well with my Lord, then remember thine handmaid. Now there's some pretty incredible things right there, and I just want to say something. Now, I don't know why I was so slow in finding this, because it's so clear. But in many places in the Old Testament stories there's a cross. The cross keeps popping up in the Old Testament. Amen? Because it's through the cross that we have forgiveness of sins. Amen? And so the cross keeps coming. And I know that in the book of Ruth, I found the cross there. When I preach on the book of Ruth, I found the cross there. The cross is in the book of Ruth. But for a while, I couldn't find the cross here in this story. But then I found it. And it's so clear when you see it. She said two things to David. You see, you've got to realize something. That David at this stage was living in caves. He was going from cave to cave. He was anointed king, but he had no kingdom. It looked less like this man had a kingdom than any other time. He was running from cave to cave. Hunted by Saul. Anointed king, but had no kingdom. And yet Abigail was willing to be identified with David when he was like that. She said, when the Lord has dealt well with you, David, when you come into your kingdom, I want you to remember me. Now, we're going to see the cross. Because on the cross, with Jesus, hung a thief. And he said, this man, looking at Jesus, has done nothing amiss. Speaking of Jesus, he said the same words as Abigail, just slightly phrased it differently. He said of Jesus Christ, there's no evil in this man. This man has done nothing amiss. Now, right? What did Abigail say? Evil hath not been found in thee all thy days. Abigail was willing to be identified with David when he had no kingdom. It certainly didn't look like Jesus had a kingdom right then, did it? He's dying on a cross. And yet this thief on the cross gets a revelation. And he says that this man has done nothing amiss. And then he says, like Abigail said the same thing, he said, remember me when you come into the kingdom. Amen. Glory to God. Two men dying on a cross. One man accepts Christ. Hallelujah. And you know what Jesus could have said? He said it in a sort of a different way, but what he could have said is he could have looked at that man and smiled at him. They're just about ready to face death and said, we're going to paradise. He said, this day thou shalt be with me in paradise. Amen? Glory to God. Isn't that wonderful? Can't you see the cross there? Abigail said, this man's done nothing amiss. There's no evil been found in thee all thy days. And then David didn't have a kingdom, but she knew he was going to. She said, you remember me when you come into your kingdom. The thief said, this man's done nothing amiss, and remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus said, this day thou shalt be with me in paradise. See, if you're going to have your life changed, you've got to have a cross experience. Amen? You've got to come to a cross experience. And can't you see the cross there? It's so clear. The two phrases that was used by the thief was used by Abigail. He said, my Lord, fight the battles of thee, Lord, and evil hath not been found in all thy days. Jesus said, I will build my church. And it shall come to pass when the Lord shall dealt well with my Lord according to all the good he has spoken. Remember me. Remember me, Abigail says. There's the cross. It was Luke 23:41 when the thief on the cross said, this man hath done nothing amiss. And then he said, Lord Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto thee, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Amen. You see, Jesus was called no evil in him. Pilate's wife said, this is a just man. I dreamed about him. Pilate said, what evil hath this man done? Pilate said three times, I find no fault in this man. Amen. The centurion, when Jesus died, said this was a righteous man. This was a righteous man. Amen. So there are lots of witness that. You see, on Calvary there was three crosses. One cross portrayed a thief dying in sin. The other cross, a thief dying to sin. But the center cross speaks of the Redeemer dying for sin. Amen? Amen. And we don't have to die in sin if we come to Christ. We don't have to. Okay. And so what I'm saying is, folks, is this. So don't you think things are going to start to change in Abigail's life now? Amen? Don't you think so? Because she's had a real cross experience. This woman's never going to be the same again. Amen? She's had a wonderful experience of coming to Christ. That's what it's a type of. So how does David react to that? Listen to this. Listen to this. 1 Samuel 25:35. So David received of her hand that which she had brought him, and said unto her, what? Go up in peace. He said to her, now you can go in peace. How could you go in peace back to a house like she had? But he said, go in peace to thine house. See, I've hearkened to thy voice. And more powerfully, I've accepted your person. You see, you've got to realize when we come to the cross, that's what Jesus says to us. He says, go in peace. He said, I've heard your voice, I've hearkened your voice, and I've accepted your person. Isn't it wonderful that the Lord does that? He forgives us. He hears us. He gives us peace. He said, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. He gives us supernatural peace, which cannot be explained, but we know we've got it in our heart and in our spirit. Amen. Go in peace. I've heard your voice. I've accepted you. What did Jesus say over and over again? I'll quickly go through it. Mark 5:34. He said unto her, daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace. Amen. In Luke 7:50, he said, thy faith hath saved thee. Go in peace. Amen. He said again in Luke 8:48, he said, be of good comfort, thy faith hath made thee whole, go in peace. He said in Mark 4:39, he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, peace be still. The Bible says in Luke 2:14, the angel said, on earth peace for God's people. Jesus thus spake, himself stood in the midst of them and said, peace be unto you. That's after his resurrection. He stood in the midst of his disciples, just peered in the room, and said, peace be unto you. Peace I leave with you. John 14:27. My peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth. We got a wonderful peace when we're Christians. Give I unto thee. Amen. I've had to drive so much on this trip. I've been out to preach at Missoula and Montana, down in Lewiston, into Billings, drive all the way back to Spokane, up north of Spokane, out to Omak preaching, north up north and right down to Medford in Oregon, down the bottom of Oregon, out to Bend. I've been all over the place. I've been driving so much. But you know, as I've been driving, I've had a glorious peace. It's like 8 hours of drive and it's just been a wonderful time of talking with the Lord and thanking him for so many things that we have to thank him, and thanking God I've got the time to thank him as I've been driving along and looking at your beautiful country. I drove through from Yakima. I had a meeting in Yakima, when was it, Thursday night, and the road was closed, this road coming down here by the Columbia River, so I came straight through the Highway 12 and hit I-5 and drove past Mount Rainier and saw Mount Adams, and just able to, you know, there's two books. There's the Bible, God's great book, and there's the book of creation, which God says all men's without excuse. You can't look at that book without realizing there's a God. And he's real, amen? The Bible says by the things that are created, we're without excuse. We just see them and we marvel at the handiwork of God. And how can you not have a bit of peace when you look at what God did? Anyway, let's move on. Go in peace. Preaching peace. The way of peace have they not known, Romans 3:17. They preach the gospel of peace, glad tidings of good things. But the kingdom of heaven is what? Righteous and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. The God of peace he's called. Live in peace and God of peace will be with you. For he is our peace. So many scriptures about it. Let the peace of God rule in your heart. Now the Lord of peace give you peace. And he said, I've hearkened to your voice. God attends unto our prayer. It says in Psalm 61, verse 1, hear my cry and attend unto my prayer. And he hears our voice. Hearken to the voice of my cry, one psalm said as he cried to God. Let your request be made known to God, because God hears us. Hearken therefore unto the supplication and hear thee. And so God, and then he says, I've accepted thee. You know, it's wonderful that the Lord accepts us. The Lord said, I've accepted thee. In Job 42 verse 9. Shall be accepted upon my altar, the sacrifice. He hath made us accepted in Christ, it says in Ephesians 1 6. God now accepts us. Isn't that fantastic? Okay. We're moving on with the story now, and I know you're all getting hungry and you're thinking about that food. Some of you are thinking about your bed. But we've got to get this story finished. Now, what's going to happen when Abigail gets home? She didn't tell him she was going to this meeting. But she's on her way home now. What's going to happen? Isn't this going to be exciting? Glory to God. Let's see what happens. Let's find some wonderful things here. In 1 Samuel 25:36, Abigail came to Nabal, and behold, he held a feast in his house. You know, the devil often has his big party just before he's going to lose something. Sometimes he just tries to throw a party. And he held a feast in his house like the feast of a king. He thought he was going great. And his heart was merry within, for he was very what? This guy looks worse and worse. He was very drunken. Now how can you talk to a drunk man? How can you witness to a drunk man? You ever try to? When a man's real, real drunk? It's hard to talk to them, you know? I remember being on the open air one time in Brisbane, Australia. And it was a really good open air, you know, when they preached, but they had a lot of singing and people would stop and listen to the singing, and then they have little short testimonies of the word and about Jesus. And people were still there listening, you know, waiting for the next song. And it was a good open air, but there was a drunk there. He was as drunk as anything. And I was standing because I was just walking up the street. I couldn't but help but listen to these wonderful group of Christians witnessing on the street corner. And amazed at how many people stopped to listen to them. You know, usually a guy screaming with a red face. And you, ooh, and you think, man, I can't hang around this guy. He's screaming so loud. And you think, well, what about the poor people in the world? But this was a real good outreach on the street corner. And I had to listen. I thought, I'm going to learn some lessons from this. This is good. And this drunk was there. And this drunk went up to one of the preachers and said, what church do you belong to? And he said, we're just Christians and we love the Lord. And the drunk said, yeah, but you got to belong to a church, because he's all over the place, you know. He said, no, we're just Christians, we love the Lord. He said, every church has its name. You got the Mormons, you got the Roman Catholics, you got the Methodists. He said, you know, everyone's got a name. What's your name? What's your church name? He said. And the preacher could see he wasn't getting very far with the guy, so he said a scripture in Hebrews. He says, we are the General Assembly and Church of the Firstborn, whose names are written down in heaven. Oh, that's a good scripture, isn't it? We're the General Assembly and the Church of the Firstborn, whose names are written down in heaven. I'll never forget it, because I was standing well back by this time, but I heard it all, and the drunk comes wandering past me, right past me, scratching his head. He had hair all over the place, a bit like me sometimes. He had hair all over the place. And as he went past me, he'd not forgotten the words that were spoken to him. He was mumbling, I've never heard of that name before. I've never heard of that church before. General Assembly and Church of the Firstborn, whose names are written down in heaven. He said, wow. He'd never heard of a church like that before. Anyway, Abigail comes back and he's having a feast like a king. His heart's merry, he's drunk. Wherefore she told him nothing. How can you tell a man that's that drunk anything? He doesn't even remember. You know, I worked at the airport for a number of years in New Zealand before I was called in the ministry. And sometimes I'd have to go to something because it'd be the farewell for someone at work and everyone would get drink. And the accountant used to like to sit next to me, and the more he drank, the more he confessed his sins to me. He knew I was a Christian, but he was acting like he thought I was a priest and he had to go to confession. And that's what happened. But, you know, this particular night, the accountant, by the time he got out of that place, he was so drunk he couldn't walk. And then I didn't leave for a little while. I'm just drinking my lemonade. And I'm just going home, and he's lying in a puddle. And he's saying, I'm going to be sick. Lift me up. I'm so sick. So I picked him up out of the water, and all his face is muddy. And I lifted him up.
And I'm going to pull him away from the puddle. But he said, put me down, quick, I'm going to be sick again, I'm going to be sick, and I put him down. I thought, man, what's this guy, what can I do with him? And you know, I didn't, what can a good Samaritan do in a situation like that? I couldn't carry him on my back. I didn't have a donkey. Otherwise I might have been able to do something. But he said, lift me up. So I lift him up again. I got him up in the air. And this time I thought, I'm not going to worry how much he says put me down, because I think he might drown in this puddle. And so I pulled him out of the puddle. Put him down on high, dry ground. Got him away from the puddle. And he said, oh, and then he was vomiting. And you know, and they reckon this is having fun. And I just left him there. You might think I wasn't a good Samaritan, but I left him there because I knew he'd been that place before. And I went home, and a couple of days later he was at work and we're having lunch there, and I said to him, I said, how did you enjoy the party? He said, man, wasn't it fabulous? Man, he said, I had a great time. The guy was as sick as a dog, lying in a puddle. Man, and you know, it's like she said, she told him nothing. How can you tell a man that drunk anything? She told him nothing until the morning light. Now, the morning light is kind of special. The morning light's when God gets the victory in the Bible. Amen? The morning light. Listen to this verse. She told him nothing till the morning light. It says in Psalm 49:14, the upright shall have dominion in the morning. The morning's a good time. I've noticed that. Have you ever noticed that? The morning's a good time. I worked on a farm. My dad was milking cows. We used to get up at early in the morning because we were the first pickup. They didn't have refrigerated tanks then. So you were rostered to finish your milking at certain times so the tanker could come around and get your milk fresh. The tanker was refrigerated, but we didn't have refrigerated tanks, just stainless steel, plain tanks. Later on we got nice big thick ones that, you know, you could milk any time of the day and leave your milk there for the tanker. But you know, every time I saw the sun come up, I thought, those poor people in the city, they're missing the best part of the day. Beautiful, the morning. You know, if you're fasting, have you ever done a few days fasting? Kind of interesting when you fast. I've kept my diary on a few fasts that I've done, longer ones than that. But when you're fasting and really seeking the Lord, the afternoon is the worst time. You feel like you want to break the fast. You just got to hang in there. But when you go to bed at night and when you wake up in the morning, that's the best time. Mm-hmm. All the fast I've done, the morning is always the best time. You've got more strength in the morning. You know, you don't have a lot. That's why you don't try and do too much during the day. But that's how it is. So in the morning is when we'll have divinity. The Bible says in Psalm 35, weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. Praise God. Bible says in Hosea 6:3, then shall we know if we follow on to know the Lord. Are we all following on to know the Lord? Of course we are. Paul said that I may know him, that his going forth is prepared as the morning. And he shall come unto us as the latter and the former rain unto the earth. Bible says Malachi 4:2, but them that fear my name shall the sun, S-U-N, but it's really talking about the S-O-N, shall the Son of Righteous arise with healing in his wings, and you shall tread down the wicked. Amen. The morning's a good time. Amen. The day of thy power, from the womb of the morning, the Bible says. I love that, Isaiah 21:11. I love that. The watchman, you see, the Jewish day begins with the night and ends up with the day. Jewish calendar goes from darkness to light. But in our Roman calendar, we go from light to darkness. You see, that's the best the world can do for us. We go from light to darkness. It gets worse. But God's calendar works different. It's night and day. It's not day and night. That's what the Bible says in Genesis. It was night and day. God takes us from darkness to light. The path of the just is a shining light that shineth more and more, glory to God, unto the perfect day. Amen. And that's the way it is. That's the way it is. And I love this story in Isaiah 21:11. He came to the watchman and he said, watchman, what of the night? What of the night? You know, a lot of people say, look at the world. We've got all sorts of things happening. I mean, you guys got a lot happening at the moment. Banks going down the tubes and
You've got all sorts of things happening. And you know, Bible says that men's hearts will fail for fear for the things coming on the world. And the Bible says that there'll be perplexity of nations. So it's going to get worse. But Jesus said, when you see these things, look up. Look to me. Keep your eyes on Jesus. In spite of the storm, as long as Peter had his eyes on Jesus, he didn't sink. When he looked at the circumstances, he started to sink. Amen? And some of the things that go on in the world enough to make you feel depressed. Really? But we've got to keep our eyes on the Lord. And so this guy came to the watchman and said, "Watchman, what of the night? What of the night? Look at all the bad things that's happening in the world." You know? There's an evangelist in South Africa. I've been to South Africa preaching 5 or 6 times. And there's a man of God there that I've stayed with him. And I've seen what he does for the Lord, and it's quite tremendous. I've seen the villages changed by his preaching, and I've gone back a few years later and seen the fruit of that. But you know, he was interviewed live on television in South Africa. I'll never forget that. I had the TV on when it happened, by a secular non-Christian, and he said to him, "You know, you've been preaching a good part of your life. The gospel's been around for 2,000 years," and then he gave him a whole lot of figures that were all negative. This many people doing this, this many people doing that. And he said, "Look, the world's getting worse. So in spite of the gospel that you preach, nothing seems to be getting better, it's getting worse." And this preacher, bless his heart, he's such a wise man. He said to this man that was witnessing to him, he said, "Well, that's funny you should mention that." Because he said, "Soap, they found some soap in Pharaoh's tomb. Soap goes back thousands of years before Christ. Soap's been around a long time. But there's a lot of dirty people." He said, "You can buy soap in any supermarket, but," he said, "the soap's got to be applied to your life to make you clean." He said, "The gospel's just like that." He said, "You can leave your Bible sitting on the mantelpiece, but you need to open its pages and read it and apply it to your life, and then you'll change." And the guy said, "Let's talk about something else." Because that didn't work out so well for him, you know. And another time, this evangelist was in a waiting room to be interviewed, and there were 4 studios there. Although the guy that was sitting next to him probably thought there's only one studio, or thought all the studios were all talking about the same thing. Because this guy sitting opposite him was a horse trainer, a horse owner. He owned horses, racing horses. So he figured that this preacher must also be into horses. So he said to him, "Are you into horses?" He said, "I sure am. I'm into horses in a big way." "Oh," he said, "and what horse do you like the best?" He said, "I like the white horse in the book of Revelation." Now, horses have weird names, so that didn't faze him out at all. So he's thinking, "I haven't heard of that horse." And then this preacher said to me, asked the fatal question. He said, "Who's the rider on that horse?" And he preached to him Jesus, because that horse is the Word of God is riding that horse. Amen? Glory to God. Anyway, come on, I've got to finish this. Why did you get me sidetracked like that? Okay, in the morning, he said to the watchman, "What of the night? What of the night?" You know what the watchman answered? I like what he answered. The watchman said, in the next verse 12, "The morning cometh." Amen. We're looking to the morning. Amen. We're looking to the morning. The morning cometh. The day breaketh. Amen. And it's coming. Okay. Let's move on. You still in 1 Samuel 25? And it came to pass in the morning. That was a special time. 1 Samuel 25 verse 37 we're reading. "It came to pass in the morning, when the wine was gone out of him, that his wife told him all these things." She told him what happened. Amen. And what happened to him? His heart died within him. Oh, glory to God, I'm getting so happy. And he became, you don't have to watch television, just read your Bible. It's full of exciting things. And his heart became as stone. It's like this man had a massive heart attack. He went, he dropped on the ground. And probably Abigail could have stood back and said, "Glory be to God. God's setting me free. You can't have any mercy on this thing.
Remember, it's evil in its doings, and we need to be married because our first husband's hopeless. We've got to be married to another, but we can't, according to Romans, be married to another till the other husband died. You know? Isn't that right? No. Mind you, in the Old Testament, I said this one time in a holiness church, and it looked like they'd never invite me back again. They were shocked. But it just fitted the middle of my sermon. I said, you know, in the Old Testament, people could get remarried if the partner committed adultery. Oh, you'll never come back here again to preach. And now you're looking at me like that too. But it's true. A person could get remarried if the partner committed adultery. Amen. Isn't God wonderful how he fixed that up? Because the one that committed adultery was stoned to death. That's true. Leviticus says if a partner commits adultery, they're to be stoned to death. What does that leave for the partner that's left? They're free to remarry, aren't they? Come on now. Amen. Am I talking the truth or not?
Amen.
You see, I think back in those old days, there weren't too many people committing adultery. If it was a death penalty. Amen?
Yes.
Come on now. You'd be saying, oh, my mate, you know, he used to work with me, but they took him out and stoned him. He committed adultery. Anyway, I'm getting sidetracked. Okay, so his heart died within him, and he became as what? Stone. I believe this is what happens to our old nature the moment we're saved. It's not dead yet, but it's pretty sick. Amen? It's got, like Spurgeon said, it's deathly blow. Because she did what? Confessed what would happen. You see, you got to confess. Confession will help the old man to die. Amen? So his heart died with him, became a stone. And the Bible says in Romans 10:9, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God raised from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, but with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. She had to tell that old rotter, I have no mercy for him, that evil stinking man, she had to tell him what it was all about, that she'd met Jesus, that her life was changing. That was a shock for him. He was, mind you, he was suffering from a hangover. Didn't help either. Bible says, nevertheless, among the chief rulers, John 12:42, many believed on Jesus, but because of the Pharisees, they did not confess him, lest they should be thrown out of the synagogue. They would have been better to confess Jesus and get thrown out. Amen. Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwelleth in him and he in God. You see, when Abigail kept calling David Lord all the time, she was applying the principle of deliverance in Isaiah 26:13. O Lord our God, other lords besides thee have had dominion over us. And that's true. A lot of us have got gods having dominion over us. But we'll only mention your name. What happens then? They're dead. They shall not live. They're deceased. They shall not rise. There's nothing more dead than this. Thou hast visited them and destroyed them and made all their memory to perish. The Bible says they're dead, they're dead, they're dead. Because you make him your Lord. Why do you think she was saying, my Lord, all the time? She wanted to get rid of this thing that was so evil in its doings. Amen? Those that feared the Lord spake often to one another, the Bible says, Malachi 3:16, the Lord and hearkened and heard it. And they thought upon his name. And so we need to speak the truth. We need to confess the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay. And, you know, there's got to be death. There's an old dying firm. They used to die, you know, not a dying firm. But, you know, they dyed clothing and they had advertised in their windows, we die to live and we live to die. The more we die, the more we live. And the more we live, the more we die. And that's the way it is with the Christian. If we die, he lives. Amen? Okay. And so we don't love our lives unto the death. Amen. Now, we're going to close this soon, in a while. But I want to read what George Whitfield wrote, because he said the same as Finney and Moody and Spurgeon. But I think what he says is very, very important, because the old man is not completely dead now. Amen. But
there's coming a time soon when we won't see evil anymore. It'll be the finish. What a day that will be. And that's when the marriage takes place. It can't take place until he's finished. But he certainly got a pretty heavy blow. His heart became a stone. Amen. That's why people, you know, a guy witnessed to me, he was a drunk. He used to drink all the time, always went to the pub. And he got saved. And he said he went into the bar and did his usual thing. Because the old man was so used to doing that. He ordered his big glass, put his hand to it. And he said, I lifted up and I couldn't get my hand any closer than that. He said, the weirdest thing. I put the glass back again. I thought, that's queer, unusual. So he picked up again and tried, I'm going to get it to my mouth this time. He couldn't get his hand to bring it to his mouth. He tried three or four times and realized that God was in it. And he walked out of that hotel and never drank again. Because the old man was paralyzed. Amen. He'd got his deathly blow. Glory to God. Listen to what George Whitfield says. Listen to this. This is powerful when you think of it in the light of this beautiful story in 1 Samuel 25. When I discover, George Whitfield said, a new corruption in my life. When I discover, through reading the word or whatever way God speaks to us, a new corruption in my life, I'm as thankful. He's thankful. As a continual, keeping watch in the garrison would be at spying a struggling enemy come near to him. I stand not fighting with it myself and my own strength, but run immediately and tell the captain of my salvation, Jesus Christ. And by the sword of his spirit, he soon destroys it and makes me exceeding happy. Isn't that wonderful? It's George Whitfield. This is what I call a simple looking to Christ. I know of no other effectual way of keeping the old man down, of keeping the what? The old man down after he's gotten his deadly blow. You would have thought he read 1 Samuel 25. Because that's what it's all about. He got his deadly blow. And George Whitfield said, I know of no other way of keeping the old man down after he's gotten his deadly blow. The old nature remains in the Christian. It has received a blow which will ultimately be its death. This is Spurgeon now. The old nature remains in the Christian. It has received a blow that will ultimately be its death, but it still lives, and the new nature in the Christian comes to struggle with it for the mastery. The battle certainly end right. Just anticipate for a moment the glory of the victory. You shall be free from sin one day. You shall be perfect, even as your Father who is in heaven is perfect, and shall wave the palm branches rejoicing. Amen. If God shall put the new nature in you, Spurgeon said, your old nature shall not be able to control it. The new immortal principle shall get the mastery. You shall be kept from sinning. You shall be preserved in holiness, though you will have to mourn over your imperfections, yet you'll feel that you have God's own life in you. And though you'll realize that you're not perfect yet, you'll wish you were. And this wishing to be so will be the sign of grace in your soul. And these wishes and desires will go on waxing stronger and stronger till you have mastered sin by the power of the Spirit. Now, what's going to happen to this old guy now? You know how long it took? It took 10 days. It took 10 days. 10 is a very interesting number in the Bible. I just want to go through it quickly. But it's a very, very... We'll come to the 10 in a moment. But the Bible says in 1 Samuel 25:38, it came to pass about how many days? 10 days. I think we're going through our 10 days now. You know what 10 speaks of? Trial and testing. But always afterwards comes blessing. That's the good news about 10. Yes. Always after. Do you know that the Bible always puts suffering before glory? Yes. Suffering and then glory. Yes. The suffering of this present time is not worthy compared to the glory that shall be revealed in us. And all the way through the Bible does that. Amen? Okay. So it came to pass 10 days after the Lord smote Nabal that he died. Imagine that. Who smote him?
The Lord.
Who?
The Lord.
See, what you got to realize, you can't get rid of the old nature. The Lord's got to do it. Amen? All the glory goes to Jesus. He's the only one that can put the thing to death. Amen? The Lord smote that thing that was evil in its doings, and he died. But did you imagine what went on with Abigail for those 10 days? Walking up and down the house, just waiting for him to die. We'd like to help her, wouldn't we? We could do some things, couldn't we? We could get a thick towel, a real thick one, with lots of wool in it, dip it in the water, and wrap it around his silly old head. And the guy would for sure suffocate. But you can't do that, can you?
You can't kill the old man. You've got to let God do it. I mean, there is a scripture that talks about that. It's 2 Kings 8:15. He took a thick cloth and dipped it in water and wrapped it around his face and he died. So it works pretty well, apparently. But Abigail, she probably came in there on the eighth day and there's Nabal. She said, I think he's dead. She's getting excited now. But she gets closer to the bed and she can hear him going, he's just hanging in there. But he's got to die. I'm not talking about I'm not talking about your husband now. Don't walk out of here and think I'm telling you how to kill your husband. This is about the spiritual thing that's evil in its doings. It's got to die. Amen? I like what Spurgeon said, some dream that the converted man has nothing more to seek for. But we teach not so. A man who is alive under God has greater needs than ever. Conversion is the beginning of a lifelong conflict. It's the first blow in a warfare which will never end till we are in glory. Isn't that something? It's God that giveth me strength to maketh my way perfect, the Bible says in Psalm 18:32. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. Now let me just go through this 10. Because after 10 days the Lord smote Nabal that he died. Isn't that fantastic? He was dead. 10 is what we're going through now. 10 is trial and testing, but the good news is always after blessing. You know? 10. Do you remember Rebecca going to be the bride for Isaac? Another wonderful picture of Jesus Christ. Being married to Isaac was like being married to Christ, like we just talked about in Samuel 25. But Rebekah, when the servant came down to get a bride for Isaac, he said, the woman that will water me and my camels, how many camels did he have? 10 camels. What a delightful thing to have 10 camels wanting a drink. And he said, the woman that will water me and my 10 camels, she will be the bride for Isaac. I'm just going to finish on this 10 and then we'll be through. So don't just hang in there. It won't be long. The bride for Isaac. Amen. Imagine that. So he comes down and you see it in Genesis. He kind of sat on a rock, I think, because the Bible said he sat down to see whether God had made his journey prosperous or not. It wasn't a hard job for her to give him a glass of water. But camels? Does anyone here have any idea how much water a thirsty camel can drink? Do you know?
A lot.
A lot. Does anyone else know? Well, I went straight to the camel's mouth. It's the best way to find out. I went to the biggest camel farm in Australia. You know that Australia now exports camels to the Arab countries. The camels came from there and they're running short of camels and we've got plenty. Camels all in the outback. They've gone wild. They're everywhere. So I went to the camel place in the Alice Springs in the heart of Australia near Ayers Rock to talk to the camel man. They call him the camel man because I wanted to get it right when I preached. And so I said to him, how much water can a thirsty camel drink when it's been on a long journey? He said, to be moderate, to be at the lowest figure, a camel can quite easily drink 25 gallons of water when it's thirsty. But since then he was being modest, because since then I saw a documentary on camels in the Sahara Desert and it said there the camels, when they're real thirsty going across the Sahara, can drink about 35 gallons of water. But we'll stay with 25 because that's a fair bit of water. And he showed me a camel that had been on a bit of a journey and he put a bucket of water in front of this camel and they're amazing creatures. He just puts his big floppy soft lips into the bucket. Two sucks and the whole bucket's gone. I couldn't believe it. So that's what a thirsty camel's like. Just two sucks, the whole bucket's gone. And so you think about that. She had to water the 10 camels, otherwise she would not be the bride for Isaac. We've got to go through our trials and tests, folks. And don't get bitter and twisted. And don't chuck in the sponge. Because she could have got to camel number 8, seeing that man sitting down. That's unusual for a man watching a woman work, isn't it? She could have said, look at that guy just sitting on the rock looking at me the whole time, not even helping me. She could have got a bad attitude. She could have got to the point where she just threw the bucket in the air at camel number 8. You realize how much water she had to draw for each camel, for all those camels? 250 gallons of water. That's hard work. She could have got the camel number 8 and we wouldn't blame her. She could have thrown the bucket in the air and said, forget it. You can water those last couple of camels. I'm going back to the village. I've had it. But you know something? Your trials in life are like those camels. And those camels carried her to Isaac. Your trials can be stumbling blocks if you let bitterness get in your life, or they can be stepping stones to Jesus. The camels brought her to Jesus. After 10 always comes blessing, amen? But the funny thing is, they said to her in Genesis 24:55, her brother and her mother said, Laban said, let the damsels abide with us a few days, at least 10, after that she shall go. I mean, the poor woman's already had 1 10, you don't have to have 2. And they asked her, you want to stay another 10 days? She said, no, I'm out of here. Don't blame her. She'd done her 10. It came to pass after the 10 days, Jeremiah 42:7, the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah. Nothing's worse than a prophet not being able to give the word. For 10 days he was silent. Daniel 1:12, prove thy servants, I beseech thee, 10 days, and let them give us pulse to eat and water to drink. Let our countenance be looked upon. They would not defile themselves with the meat of Babylon. They would not defile themselves with the king's meat. So they consented, verse 14, in this matter, and proved them 10 days. At the end of 10 days, their countenance was fairer than all those that ate the portion of the king's meat. They came into a blessing, amen? All the way through the Bible's 10. Revelation 2:10, you should have tribulation 10 days. Be ye faithful unto death and you'll receive a crown of life. How long did they... Jesus said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. Didn't he say that? Mm-hmm. He said, when I go, you don't have to worry. I'll send the Holy Spirit. He was 40 days with the disciples. Pentecost means 50. 10 days they had to wait in the upper room with no Jesus and no Holy Spirit. Some said there was 500 waiting. You end up with 120. Some went home. But the ones that stayed for the whole 10 days, what a blessing they got. Holy Spirit came into the room with a mighty rushing wind. Amen? Tongues of fire on their head, and they're all filled with the Holy Ghost. What a blessing they received. 10. Always, isn't it good news that after 10 always comes blessing? Elisha was 10 years with Elisha. And then Elijah said, if you see me when I go, you'll have a double portion of the Spirit upon you. So Elisha, he wasn't going back. Elijah said, go back. He said, I'm not going back. He kept looking at Elijah. And he saw him go in the chariots of fire. And a double portion of the Spirit fell upon him. But after 10 days, after 10 days, Ruth, after 10 years, Ruth and Naomi came back to the promised land and were blessed. Amen. And so there's so many, there's 10 commandments, and what do? They're the schoolmaster to bring us to Christ, where we receive great blessing. And on the Bible goes, Jacob had his wages changed 10 times, and it goes on and on, talking about that. But let's finish the story now quickly. 1 Samuel, we must finish. Okay, so he's dead. We've learned a wonderful lesson, that only the Lord can kill it. The Lord smote him that he died. Amen? He's the only one that can do it. Hallelujah for that. And so it says in 1 Samuel 25:39, when David heard that Nabal was dead, he said, blessed be the Lord. Huh? Blessed be the Lord that hath pleaded the cause of my reproach from the hand of Nabal and hath kept his servant from evil. The Lord hath returned the wickedness of Nabal upon his own head. And David sent and communed with Abigail to take her to him too. Why? Wonderful picture of the church being the wife. We're going to go to the marriage supper of the Lamb. He's our bridegroom. We'll be the wife. Amen? The bride of Christ, the Bible talks about. And when the servants of David, verse 40, were come to Abigail to Carmel, this woman was a very special woman. They spake unto her, saying, David sent us therefore to take thee to him to wife. And look at her attitude. Verse 41. She arose and bowed herself to the face, on her face to the earth, and said, behold, let thine handmaid
be the servant to wash the feet of the servants of my Lord. What a wonderful servant she was. Amen. What an attitude she had. What an attitude she had. And Abigail hasted and rode upon an ass with five. Five's the number of atonement. With five damsels with her that went after her. And she went after the messengers of David and became his what? Wife. Became his wife. Amen. Praise his wonderful name. Amen. As Charles Haddon Spurgeon said, it's the Lord who has begun the good work within us. It is he who has carried it on. And if he does not finish it, it will never be complete. If there be one stitch in the celestial garment of our own righteousness, our righteousness is filthy rags, which we are to insert ourselves, then we are lost. But this is our confidence. The Lord who begun will perfect. He's done it all and must do it all and will do it all. Our confidence must be not in what we have done, nor in what we have resolved to do, but entirely what the Lord will do. You see, some people try and make holiness the way to God. But holiness is not the way to God. The Lord is our source of holiness. The Lord is our holiness. Amen? Mm-hmm. And we only have one way to God, and that's through the mercy of Jesus Christ and through his forgiveness. And we must never forget that. He's joined us to Christ. And so that's what happens. See? And that's what happens. And that's what God wants to do. So praise his wonderful name. Let's just pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this story that we see in 1 Samuel 25. And thank you, Lord God, that suffering will come and then glory. Lord, we know your word says many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth them out of them all. Thank you for that, Father God. Praise your wonderful name. And Lord, we just thank you for this story that we saw in 1 Samuel 25, how it lays out the principles of forgiveness that we need to call you Lord. As many shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. We think of the thief on the cross. He said, Lord, remember me. And Lord, you did. And Lord God, we confess that we trust in you, that you are our salvation, and we thank you for forgiving our sins, Lord. Thank you, Lord God, you're helping us each step of the way. You said you'll never leave us nor forsake us. You said you'd be with us to the end of the world. You'll always be there, and we thank you for that, Lord God. And help each one of us in our journey that we're on. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Thank you, brother. That's right, we can sing this one. Okay, it comes from Psalm 118, verse 24. This is the day that the Lord has made, okay? Let's all stand.
Can you give us our first pitch?
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath... We will rejoice. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made.
Okay, we're going to sing it again. Because you might have noticed something about that song. It repeats itself for a reason. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. It's because there's a reason. He wants us to do it in parts. So the men will sing the first, this is the day. And the ladies, I know the ladies are going to do very well tonight. The ladies will sing the second. You ready? Can you work that one out all right? Okay, ready to go now. The man first and then the woman.
This is the day,
this is the day
that the Lord has made,
that the Lord has made.
We will rejoice,
we will rejoice
and be glad in it.
Be glad in it.
This is the day that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day,
this is the day
that the Lord hath made.
One more time and then we'll finish. And the ladies are doing so well. The men need to pick it up a little bit. The ladies are doing well, and you ladies keep on now. You're ready, we're going to go. You give the answer, the ladies give the answer, the echo.
This is the day that the Lord hath made.
We will rejoice
and be glad in it.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
We will rejoice and be glad in it.
This is the day
that the Lord hath made.
Thank you. Praise God. Amen.